But this is just a summary that we'd like, to share with you, and particularly I think at the end we have some discussion about this topic. So we try to go fast because it's, the time is short. Propolis, we know perfectly well what is propolis. These come from different plants. We have different kinds of propolis. So it's difficult to say yes, propolis and cancer. We have to say what kind of propolis and what kind of cancer. So propolis is well known for many reasons. Preserve the wood from eating from the insects and other molds, etc. And it's also very well known for other questions. But I can say that the European temperate propolis, temperate region, is produced mainly from poplars. Poplars have been produced bud. The bud is from these trees. They are very rich in resins. And these resins, as you can see in the picture, are very visible when you take the resins in the spring. And you see that this is the material is collected by bees in order to produce the propolis that you can find in most European countries. So what's interesting is that when you look at the high products, you see that propolis is present there, you know that. So if you look at the poplar and you analyze the composition of the poplar buds, and then you see the you analyze what is collected by the bee. And what is present in the hive is very similar composition in many ways. But what's more interesting here is that these components, phytochemicals that you can find in the poplar and the propolis, they are also present in the bees' works. They're also present in the honey. And they're also present in the bee scales that are recently excreted by the bee. So this means that the bee, the honeybee, has to eat propolis, and somehow the components that you see in the poplar and in the propolis, they are present as well in the recently formed excreted scales. So this is very interesting. Well, this is just a chromatographic profile of the different polyphenols you can find capillaries in these works, and below is in the walk scales. And you can see there is a very similar composition in both of them. There's mainly this kind of compounds you can find in propolis that you know very well. I will discuss this later again. And also, what is also is very relevant and interesting is that the composition, you see the chromatographic profiles of the poplar extract that we produce from the buds, alcohol. You see that the composition is very similar to what you have in propolis, and it's very similar to what you have in honey. In honey, we have in addition other components that come from nectar, that come from pollen, but propolis is there. So we can say that propolis is present in many of the bee products we have in honey. So it's important to say that the plants for propolis, the ones that we have in temperate areas, is mainly, as I told you, poplars. But there are many other origins, plant origins for different kinds of propolis in different countries. We have Morocco, we have Euphorbia, one of the main plants that is visited by the plant, by the bees, in order to collect resins. In Brazil, we have other kinds of plants, Venezuelan, Cuban, Mexican, etc. But in all these cases, instead of going and visiting the buds, when they visit these plants, these bees, tropical plants are mainly the flowers. The flower is creating some resins that need to be collected and then this become part of the propolis, which is different. So it's important to see that there are different compositions in propolis from different origins. So if we look at the composition of propolis, we can see this is the kind of phenolic compound that we can find in temperate propolis, European propolis and North American, etc. And some others are from South American or tropical countries. So what's important here is that these phenolic compounds, these flavonoids, are all of them quite lipophilic. Quite lipophilic, and this is why they go very fast into the works, and why probably this is behind the the pharmacological biological or the biological potential of these compounds from honey. If you look at this chrysin and galangin, a very, very interesting one, where we have an under-substituted green, if the same happens with pyrobanxin and pyroxanthin, the barflavanones, and they have this lipophilic B-ring, which is a quite characteristic of this group of compounds. It's quite unique. It's difficult to find this in other plant sources. But if you look at the other compounds that you can find in propolis, and they are very relevant, is the caffeic acid phenethyl ester, this one here, is also lipophilic as well. It's the same kind of structure. And in this case, there's a combination of the two hydroxy here with this benzene residue there. If you look at the main component that has been studied in green propolis from South America, you can see that this is another phenolic compound that is also very lipophilic because it contains these two isoprenoyl molecules here. So it's quite lipophilic and this is quite active. So this is just to give a quick overview of the kind of compounds you can find. But something that is really important is to consider the bioavailability and metabolism of these phenolics. So not all these compounds can be used for different kinds of ailments and different kinds of treatments because they are transformed, they are metabolized, and we are not having the same compound we have in the propolis. So absorption, phase two metabolism, and gut microbiota metabolism is very important. So if we look at the what happens. This is a very simple representation of what we have in the gut. We see that the propolis components are there, and I don't know what happened here, but this is not animated here, because I said this, it doesn't matter, because I can explain that this machine is done. So this is the composition of different kinds of phenolics that we have in the propolis. And this is the small intestine, and this is the colon. So this is the blood, and this is the intestinal barrier. So you can see that there is an absorption of this kind of compounds through diffusion, and then they can reach plasma after an hour. And sometimes there is metabolism by phase two metabolism, and sometimes it's a reversal of the transport going back into the intestine. When they reach the colon, there are many bacteria that they are known to metabolize, to degrade these kind of compounds, producing other metabolites that are better absorbed. So, this is the kind of metabolites that are produced after the degradation of the polyphenols are very well known, and this also happens in the gut microbiota. For instance, if we look at the cafe acid phenethylesters. This is later degraded by the gut microbiota into different compounds, smaller molecules that are much better absorbed. So we have to consider that this kind of gut microbiota metabolites should be studied as well, and they could be responsible for the health effects. So it's important to say that the solubility is important for absorption, and in this case, bioavailability and metabolism. And I can say that the pharmaceutical form preparation is very, very relevant in terms of the propolis. So I can tell you that probably the use of cycloestrins are the kind of vehicles to solubilize the propolis can increase the bioavailability and increase the effect you see in the end. So if we look at the propolis chemo prevention and therapy of cancer, I think this is a very interesting topic, but very difficult to prove. Because there are many studies that they try to find applications. They look at the antimicrobial and inflammatory and anti-cancer effect of different flavors and they find propolis. But there are also other components that can be also active. We have also questions, we also have terpenes, amino acids, and vitamins in propolis. So it's a very complex mixture, which is difficult to demonstrate the effect. So in addition, we can find different presentations that can be in the market. And they are close to pharmaceutical products that they can be used for different purposes. And they increase the facility for absorption, etc. So this is just an example where you can find the literature. I'm going to show you the products from Mars, which we have already seen then around. So if we look at the anti-cancer effect, what is available in the literature is that we have many studies looking at indirect effects in test tubes, like antioxidant effects. There's a lot of papers showing that there is antioxidant activity evaluation in vitro, and this correlates, what they say, this correlates with cancer, anti-cancer, all the kinds of diseases. There's also a good number of in vitro studies with human cell lines, human cancer cell lines, in which there's a lot of evidence that the propolis compounds, they induce apoptosis, they interact with the cell cycle, have cytotoxic effects, inhibit angiogenesis, which is a good thing, induce this decreases the metastasis, etc. But this is only in vitro human cancer cells. In vivo studies, what we have in hand is very few. And most of them, they are with animal models, because we cannot test very easily in human studies, in human trials, clinical trials, the effect on cancer, because it has many limitations and is difficult to carry out. So, regarding the antioxidant activity, this is what I mentioned. There is a lot of interest in the antioxidant capacity because they're reactive oxygen species. They are in the cancer initiation. So, those antioxidants that collaborate with the internal antioxidant in the body are good. But the problem is that the antioxidant effects in vivo does not correspond to what you see, in vitro, does not correspond to what you see in vivo. So, these kinds of studies have a lot of limitation because they don't consider the bioavailability, the metabolism, etc. So it's important to take this into consideration. The anti-proliferative activity, this is also a study made in vitro through different methodologies. I'm going to pass just fast because I think it's, we are not going to have much time. But you know, these are the main anti-cancer compounds that have been reported from propolis. From poplar to propolis, we have this compound here, okay, which is caffeine, acid, caffeine ester, as I mentioned before. And from green propolis, from baccarats, there's a terpene C, which is this molecule here, that has also proved some interesting effects in cancer. So most of the studies have been done with cancer cell lines against cancer and the different cell lines, and they are compared with normal cell lines, with cell lines that they are not from cancer, and they grow more slowly, and they see that there's no effect on that, but I guess there's a decrease in the effect of the cancer cell lines. So important, one of the main things that we have seen here is the apoptosis. Apoptosis is the programmed cell death. If you have a different cell lines in which you induce the apoptosis. The apoptosis is a way that these cells, they somehow degrade themselves through this mechanism. And this is, it consists of a rapid condensation of the cell membrane, close apoptotic bodies, 30% organelles. Through an intrinsic pathway involving caspase and FKB. So this is a very well-known mechanism. So it's a very good model to study an effect on cancer. And we know that propolis induced by apoptosis in melanoma, lymphoma, in many different cancer cells through this apoptotic mechanism. So this is just a picture of how human cell line is behaving when they have apoptosis. There's this kind of, groups of materials that you can see inside the cell. So it's very easy to follow and to study. So in the case, there's also a very important role of propolis is in the tumor microenvironment. And what's important here is the anti-angiogenic activity. So angiogenesis is important for giving vascular cells to the metastasis, to the new, colonization of the cancer cells in other tissues. So if you decrease angiogenesis, then you are somehow preventing the development of the cancer. So there is some evidence that propolis compounds, they also prevent the angiogenesis. But all these studies are in vitro, again. So we don't have, it's difficult to extrapolate this in vivo because all these studies are done with human to show, just to end my short presentation, something about the anti-cancer effects. And I would like to mention something about preclinical studies. These are normally called in vitro studies with animal models in which we can induce cancer, or we can just produce a model in which we use a human carcinoma cell group that we inoculate in mice, and we produce a mouse xenograft in order to evaluate the cancer effect properties. There's a nice paper, this one published in Food Chemistry by Carvalho et al. And in this case, this paper was done with properties from bacteria that euphoria from Brazil. It's a green properties. And in this case, they found these were the main constituents that were present in the properties. And we have to see ATPC and also some methylated flavonoids. And they produce an extract with canola oil and another one with ethanol at 70%. And they saw that these two extracts could be potentially useful for interacting with cancer cells. And they tested this in different human cell lines, like leukemia cell lines, colon cancer, breast cancer, brain cancer cell lines. Well, take into consideration here that we are treating systemic cells with propolis constituents and structs that they are in our original product. So this doesn't take into consideration the metabolism and bioavailability of the original compounds. But this is a very interesting effect in vitro, and they, in this study with the mouse mold xenograft, they implanted in this case a sarcoma tumoral cells from humans that were vitro cultivated into the mice, and they were able to develop these tumors in the mice, and they used this anti-cancer compound as a positive control, something that it can have an anti-cancer effect, like 5-fluoroacil, this one here, and they compared this with propolis extracts made with canola oil and with ethanol. Well, this is just a view of how these kind of mouse xenografts they develop the cancer, and you can look at the tumor, the size of the tumor, the what happened with these cells, and also you can look at the effects on all the different organs like liver, kidneys, etc., in order to see if there is a toxicity effect by the compounds we are studying. So if we look at the anti-cancer effects in people, this is just the main summary. We have two different parts in the graph. The part on top, which is related to the tumor inhibition by different treatments, and these white bars indicate the tumor inhibition. So this is the control that there's no inhibition, and this is the 5-fluorouracil treatment that is inhibiting 50% of the cancer cells. So if we look at the treatment with the different extracts we have, well, that these were produced from green propolis, you see that both the ethanol and the oil extract, they had similar effects and they were quite active, similar to what we have with 5-fluorouracil, even if the content was a bit higher when this was used in this lab. And if you look at the size and the histology of the different tissues, this shows that there is almost no change, so there is no toxicity after the treatment in the mice with this kind of structure. So just to read the conclusions about this presentation, I have to say that the propolis, or some kinds of propolis, has a good potential as a cancer chemopreventive agent. There are many studies in vitro that they show that. But the evidence so far is, however, very limited to in vitro studies. The people evidence is so far not really conclusive. The active metabolites need to be identified because we are looking at a very complex, plant origin material that is modified by bees, and this kind of very complex extract. We need to identify these are the active metabolites. If you want to standardize the structure properly, you need to know which ones are the real relevant ones. And taking in one, you can see that.